In the late 1990s, a group of researchers from Harvard University drove an SUV at 5 miles an hour down more than 11,000 city blocks. These weren't just any city blocks. They were city blocks in low-income neighborhoods in Chicago. And the SUVs weren't normal SUVs. They had cameras mounted on both sides. So as the SUVs rolled down the streets, the cameras recorded all the social activities and physical features along the way. Things like litter, graffiti, vacant lots, drug deals, and public drinking. But also features that suggested people had hope and faith in their community. Now, these researchers were not particularly concerned about environmental education or about the environment. They wanted to know why some poor neighborhoods had lower crime rates than others. So what do filming the streets of Chicago from SUVs and crime rates have to do with environmental education? Well, bear with me, and I'll eventually get to that. The scientists felt that the presence of police was not the only solution to crime in low-income neighborhoods. They had a hunch that something from within the community was present in neighborhoods that were plagued by poverty, but not by crime. And they found that neighborhoods where residents were figuring out how to solve problems together had lower crime rates. These were neighborhoods where adults were willing to watch over groups of children playing on the sidewalk and to say something to teenagers or adults who were yelling or otherwise disturbing people in parks and public spaces. The researchers also found that converting blighted lots to community gardens was another way that people worked together. Across from low-income apartments was a community garden with a sign that read, "Please respect our efforts." According to one researcher, community gardeners were able to reap a harvest of not only kale and tomatoes, but safer neighborhoods and healthier children. In fact, an earlier study had shown that public housing tenants in New York City who grew flowers and vegetables for a neighborhood beautification contest ended up organizing window watches to mobilize when someone threatened to pick their flowers and assigned troublemakers among the children to guard the plantings from vandals. In short, what started out as planting flowers grew into youth and adults cleaning up and protecting newly prized common areas and gardens, all of which required cooperating and organizing. The Chicago researchers used the term collective efficacy to describe situations in which residents believe that their neighbors are willing to intervene for the common good. Collective efficacy depends on trust and solidarity among neighbors, or social capital, and also on the willingness to take action for the betterment of one's community. Relative to social capital, collective efficacy is a more direct measure of whether community members are likely to take action for the public good. Now getting back to environmental education. Traditionally, environmental education has focused on self-efficacy, or the belief that one's own actions will produce desired outcomes, that I can make a difference. Collective efficacy takes the idea of efficacy from the level of the single individual to that of the community. In short, collective efficacy is about groups of people demonstrating that they can work together to improve social conditions. One way that communities demonstrate collective efficacy is through cleaning up vacant lots and converting them to community gardens. So you may not think of community gardening as environmental education, yet community gardening provides ample opportunities for environmental learning. Who has been to a community garden where children and adults were tending crops together and not seeing the young people express curiosity, ask questions, and actually learn a lesson about a plant, a bird, or an insect? And through community gardening, young and older people demonstrate their willingness to take action to steward our public spaces, which is a primary goal of environmental education. Collective efficacy is about tending to one's surroundings, even when those surroundings include vacant lots, vandalized buildings, and other incivilities. These affronts to everyday life communicate an attitude of not caring, of helplessness, and even hopelessness. Not unlike the hopelessness some may feel about the environment. Taking action for the collective good can provide a powerful remedy to attitudes of not caring, of helplessness, and even create hopefulness. In short, environmental education programs that demonstrate the willingness of youth and of the broader community to take action demonstrate not just self-efficacy, but also collective efficacy. These programs, whether taking place through community gardening, litter cleanups, or through other civic ecology practices, can contribute to healthier communities, can create open spaces that instead of being eyesores, provide ecosystem services like food and recreational opportunities, and afford opportunities for learning about the environment.